Zach Schumm here with the Iowa State University Plant and Insect Diagnostic Clinic, and today I'm going to show you a very basic way on how to pin a butterfly and spread a butterfly. So we have a nice fresh monarch specimen that unfortunately was not able to make its migration down to Mexico this year, and we're just going to spread this on a pretty standard spreading board. There are many different types of spreading boards available. You can just also just make makeshift ones out of insulation foam sheets that you can buy at a hardware store. Some other things that you're going to need, obviously some pins. Standard size insect pins usually work great for most insects. They sort of are the thickness of a thin sewing needle, so to speak. We are going to use forceps. I really like to use these little spade forceps that have a little shovel-like end on them. Other forceps can work decently well, but the more you get to that spatulate end of it, or sort of flattened end, that really helps to manipulate butterflies when you're spreading them, and moths as well. This one's not necessary, but it can be helpful, a pinning block. The pinning block is just going to help set the depth of the pin to the correct depth, so you don't have too much of the pin sticking out of the top of the insect or vice versa. There are some other ways to hold down the wings of butterflies. I like to use just little strips of thick paper. This is just cardstock paper. You could easily cut up a cereal box or a granola bar box and cut it into little thin strips that are long enough to essentially cover the entire width of the wings, front to back. That's all you really need for basic butterfly pinning and spreading. If you wanted to be really intricate, you could do more. Some words to the wise: when you're picking up and manipulating a butterfly specimen, you either want to grip it by the front veins on the leading wings or the forewings. Those are the thickest veins on the butterfly, so you're going to limit the amount of damage you're potentially doing. And if you're grabbing it with your hand, it's always just best to grip it by the body. You don't want to squeeze it, you just want to gently grab the butterfly. The first thing you have to do when you're spreading a butterfly is to put the pin inside the specimen itself. So you want the pin to go through the thorax of the insect, and you want it to be directly perpendicular to the body. So this is sometimes the hardest part to do, is to look at the body and look at which way is exactly perpendicular and get the pin in perfectly. It's really hard to do when it comes with practice, and I still to this day get it wrong every once in a while. So I'm going to pinch the butterfly in between my two fingers. Again, other people can do this a little bit differently, but this is what I like to do. And I'm going to take my pin that is a good size for this body. You don't want the pin to take up the entire width or thickness of the thorax, or you're going to have a damaged butterfly or specimen. And I'm going to stick it about midway down the thorax and gently push the pin in and through the body. And this is a good time to check to make sure that your pin is going in perpendicular to the body. You don't want it to be angled in one way or the other, or you can, again, just have a lot of trouble pinning your specimen. And we're going to push this pin in until it's about halfway through. Then what I'm going to do is I'm going to take this pinning block and I'm going to put it flat on the table, grab the top of that pin, making sure I'm not grabbing and putting any pressure on the wings, and I'm going to push it into the top hole of this pinning block. And I'm just going to push down until the pin meets the table underneath. And that essentially sets the pin at the correct depth. In general, you want an insect pin to be sticking out of your specimen about a centimeter. You probably can't see that very well in the image, but the top of this pin is sticking out maybe just a little hair under a centimeter. For the actual pinning portion, we have this spreading board here that has an adjustable width. So you can see these little wood sections, they can move in and out a little bit. And what you want for butterflies and moths is for that section in the middle, which is going to be for the insect's body or the butterfly's body, to just barely fit inside that crevice. You don't want there to be too little space in there where you're damaging your butterfly by shoving it into that space. You don't want that space to be too big. You'll see why that could be problematic here momentarily. So I'm just going to take this butterfly, I'm going to come to the top of the spreading board, and I'm going to push down on the specimen until I can't any further. And I just reached issue number one, where I've pushed this butterfly down all the way, but the wings are not level with this wood top to the spreading board. So if I were to move these wings down right now, they'd be at a weird angle, and I could potentially do some damage to the butterfly. If you're looking right now, and I push the wing down, there's a gap between the body and the, I guess, the top of the wing and where it's actually meeting the top of the spreading board. So I'm going to have to make an adjustment already, where I'm just going to align the top part of this wing here close to the body, and make it level with the spreading board wood. So what I'm going to do there is I'm just going to take these forceps. You could use your fingers, you just have to be really gentle, especially with smaller specimens. And I'm going to push the body down so that it goes in that little crevice there. I might have to widen this a little bit so the body actually fits properly. And I'm going to just push it down the pin a little bit until these wings, as you can see, are now perfectly flush with the wood top of the spreading board. We're in good shape now. The pin is sticking out a little bit more than I would like for a specimen, but it's perfectly fine. So the next thing I'm going to do is I'm going to pin down the wings, and then I'm going to move them into position and essentially seal them down and just let the specimen dry like that. And that's what we use these little paper strips for. I like to use paper strips. Again, some people like to use things that cover the entire wing, like a big square of wax paper. I just find this method a little bit easier, especially for beginners. So I like to move the specimen to the side like this, and I'm just going to start one side at a time, placing that little strip of paper over top of the wing of the butterfly. I'm going to take a spare pin and just pin it down on one side. So if I do this, you'll notice that the wing is already sort of being held down. So I'll take another pin and I'll just do that to the top part of the wing, or to the top part of the paper. And right now that wing is entirely held down, and we'll do the manipulation and the movement of the wing here shortly. But before I do that, I like to do the same exact thing to the other side. So I'll take that pin or that piece of paper, take a pin, and just seal it in like that. Again, doing it with both sides. Now our butterfly is on our spreading board. We have the pin at a decent depth. We have the wings perfectly flush with the top of the spreading board. Next, what we're going to do is manipulate the wings and get it into the correct position, or whatever position I want this butterfly to be in when it dries. Again, this is why I like the paper method, because when you cover the entire wing with wax paper, it can make it hard to make little fine-tune adjustments. With this two-piece of paper strip method, all you have to do is lift up one part of the pin. I do the one for the forewing first, so that's the top wing closest to the head. I'll pick one side of the butterfly. I will loosen the pin on that is essentially holding down the forewing. I'm going to take my spatulate forceps, and I'm going to gently go underneath the wing, gently grab the leading vein, or the thickest vein at the top of the wing, and just slowly adjust that wing forward until it's at the position that I like. Every single person, I think, likes to spread butterflies or open their wings up a different amount. I just do it essentially until I like the look of it. There's not really any real rules about this unless you're doing some research collections, and even then there's some flexibility. And then I'm going to do the same thing with the bottom wing. I'm going to lift up the bottom. I'm putting my finger a little bit of pressure on the front wing here, just so when I release the pressure from the back, that front wing doesn't start coming back down, because it's going to want to naturally start coming back this way. But I'm going to put some pressure on that forewing, release the pressure on the back wing, again, gently get my forceps underneath of that bottom wing, grab it by the thickest veins, which are again up front, usually, and just kind of move this into a good position and put pressure back down on the specimen, or the pin, sorry, that holds down the hind wing. So I have this in position now, and if I release my finger, you'll notice that the wings do not move. They're staying in place where I wanted them to be. And from this point, you do the same exact thing for the left side, and you're usually in pretty good shape. Sometimes there are some fine adjustments that you have to make to, you know, make sure both sides are even. If you have the body of the insect, you know, angled one way or the other, that can sort of mess up the angles and the look that you're trying to create, which is why having that crevice or the gap in the middle, the perfect size of the body, is really important, because it keeps that specimen completely parallel with that crevice. So just for the other one, again, I'm just going to release pressure from that front wing there, gently get my forceps underneath of it, grab it by that top vein, and I'm just going to slowly move it up until it matches the other side, at least as close as I can tell. Push that pressure down again, and I can release. Rotate. I do a lot of rotating here just so that I can get, you know, a good view, or I can at least reach or grab the wing at the part that I'm trying to grab. Same thing with the hind wing. And for this one, I usually look at what I did on the other side and make sure that the same exact points or things on the wings are visible. So on this other side, I made a good reference where there's a little white dot that's showing on the hind wing, just under the forewing. I'm going to do that same exact thing on the other side. Find that little white dot, make sure it's barely visible. And if my forewings are at the same level, then it should be a perfectly symmetrical specimen at that point. Just hold that down, and we should be good to go. You can add additional reinforcements onto this if you wanted to put more paper strips on that specimen to make sure that there's no movement as it starts to dry. That's perfectly fine. You can also use additional pins to hold down the antenna or to move the wings in any orientation you like. The antenna on this one are fine. I'm not personally too picky about where the antenna are, but you could just move them a little bit. I just used a pin to push down the antenna a little bit so they're not sticking straight up in the air. There's lots of different movements you can do. You can hold down the body in that regard too. You could put a strip of paper over the abdomen if the abdomen's sticking up a lot. Essentially, you're just trying to get the specimen gently into a position that it's able to dry. They're kind of like leaves. Once the specimen is dead, it'll dry up and stay like that for pretty much ever unless there's some other force that damages it or destroys it. And that is how you basically spread a butterfly.